Hello and welcome to Disastrous History. Today we're going to talk about one of the most infamous tornadoes in American history, the 1997 Gerald, Texas F5 tornado. This tornado became infamous almost immediately because of a photo taken of it by a local by the name of Scott Beckwith at Gerald Farm Supply. In the photo, you can see three sub-vortices. You can see this one here, and then this one here, and then this one up here. And it appears to be like a man walking forward with what has been described as a scythe that is coming out of the top of it and has been described as looking similar to like the Grim Reaper. Now, this particular tornado is going to end up being similar to the Grim Reaper, but we will get there. Now, the supercell that produced this tornado first fired up at the boundary of a cold front near Waco, Texas, a little over 40 minutes north of Gerald, and lazily drifted to the southwest at around noon on May 27th, 1997, at a speed of around 5 miles per hour. That is very slow for a supercell storm. At around 1 p.m., the Storm Prediction Center out of Norman, Oklahoma, issued a tornado watch for the area of College Station, Texas, to Shreveport, Louisiana, due to an incredibly unstable air mass over the region. We're talking in the neighborhood of 6,000 or so Cape. It was very unstable, but it had relatively low shear, which if you're unfamiliar, you need shear in order to produce tornadoes because you need shear. It's wind that changes directions as you get higher in the atmosphere. You need that shear in order to get the rotation actually going so that you can create a tornado that rotates. And then you need the unstable air mass to help produce the thunderstorms that will then go on to create the tornado. They had a ton of cape, but not very much shear. Now, prior to the Gerald tornado that is infamous, there were actually multiple other tornadoes put down by this storm system. They were right about the amount of shear, but they were wrong about it not being able to produce tornadoes. 7 total tornadoes would touch down prior to this big one we're going to talk about today. One of those tornadoes was on the ground for 20 minutes, but moved a grand total of 1.7 miles, which is very slow storm speed for a tornado. At 3:40 p.m., the tornado that would become known as the Gerald tornado and the Dead Man Walking tornado touched down just northwest of Gerald. Initially as a small rope tornado, it rapidly expanded into a massive half-mile-wide black wall. Now, the thing about the Dead Man Walking photo is that it's not very well known that Scott Beckwith actually took a series of photos that captured the full tornado genesis of this particular tornado. So we're going to go through them here in sequence. So you can see here on the left, this is as it's starting to rope out and go towards the ground. It gets a little bit lower here in the second photo. In this third photo here, you can see it's starting to retract a little bit, but you can start to see the dust kick up on the ground here. In this fourth photo, it has fully touched down as a very narrow rope tornado. You can also see the dust starting to kick up here as well as it starts to make that dust cloud down at the bottom of the base of the tornado. And as we get further along here, you can see it is fully touch down here as it continues on and starts to strengthen. The funnel disappears a little bit, but you can definitely see this dust cloud as it's starting to form on the ground, picking up significantly more dirt and debris on the ground. This next set of photos starts to show the tornado rapidly expanding and strengthening significantly. You can see in this photo, you can see somewhat the column as it's going down and this dust cloud forming around it. You can see even better in this photo as you can see the center rotation of this particular tornado as it starts to expand outward. Then in this set, you can see this center vortex right here on the outside right here. You can see this vortex starting to extend down. The tornado is rapidly expanding up top. This vortex is dropping down. Here you can see this expansion up here. That vortex has fully touched down all the way to the ground. And then, of course, here you have your infamous Dead Man Walking. You can see this sub-vortex right here looking like a foot and leg that's stepping out, and this vortex here that's going straight down like the leg that's standing, and then what people have described as a scythe here. Then over here, you can see where it has combined into one significantly larger vortex in the center of this dust cloud surrounding it. And as we continue on, you can see that it is still expanding significantly and getting significantly darker, which indicates there is more debris inside this tornado already. The next one, you can see it has expanded even further, still getting very wide at this point. At this point, you can see this is a very powerful tornado that is moving on, and this has changed color a little bit, partially because he's clearly moved from where he's taking the photo of, so there's a different set of lighting, but it's still rapidly expanding in width in this second photo right here. And then the next set of photos on the left, you can see it is still expanding. On the right, it's more or less the same size, but has very clearly reached violent level strength. And then in these last two photos, you can clearly see that this is just a massive, violent tornado that is essentially a black wall of death that is headed directly for Gerald, Texas. After this tornado rapidly expanded into this massive half-mile-wide black wall that you currently see, it crossed over three separate county roads, County Road 308, County Road 305, and County Road 307. Now, normally when a tornado passes over a road, it just kind of moves on and it doesn't really do anything. That is not what happened with the Gerald, Texas tornado. On one of those county roads, it ripped off approximately 525 yards of asphalt, completely stripped the road bare of asphalt. This tornado next set its sights on the town of Gerald, Texas, specifically the Double Creek subdivision of Gerald on the north side. As it approached, siblings John and Michael Ruiz left their mobile home and headed to the well-built structure next door of the Moorings after hearing the tornado siren as they had been taught. The Moorings' home was a two-story, well-built, anchored structure that had mom, dad, two kids inside. They took in Michael and John and went into shelter. Nearby, Larry and Joan Ego ushered their children into shelter inside their home as the tornado approached. Moments later, the tornado entered the Double Creek subdivision at 3:48 p.m. It's known exactly what time it entered the subdivision because one of the only tangible things recovered was a single stopped clock at 3:48. It also expanded to 3/4 mile wide. Now, being hit by a tornado on a normal day is never a good thing, but the problem with this particular tornado as soon as it entered Double Creek subdivision was the tornado had essentially stalled in place at F5 strength. The first home to be impacted was the Egos. For 3 agonizing minutes, 200 plus mile per hour winds ripped the home to shreds. Quite literally, nothing was left. The home, the cars, everything was granulated to a tiny level. All 5 members of the Ego family died. They had absolutely no chance. You see, most homes in Gerald and most homes in that area of Texas in general do not have basements. Therefore, they were trying to hide in the most center portion of their house. Unfortunately, a tornado that sits in place has plenty of time to tear into the center part of your house. You can see on this what was the foundation of a home, the only thing left is a little piece of the sill plate on the far right edge of this foundation. The next home hit was the Moorings. It ripped every single inch of the home apart, including removing the sill plates from the foundation. Everyone inside died. In a cruel twist of fate, the sibling boys, John and Michael Ruiz's mother, Maria, was also killed by the tornado, driving home in a desperate attempt to reach them. Their mobile home they had fled from for the safer location of the well-built two-story home, barely damaged. One mother and daughter were in their bathtub being protected by the father when their home was obliterated around them. The tornado carried off the father, killing him. The daughter was found badly injured and covered in mud, but alive in a nearby field. Mother was found clinging to a tree in her front yard, also badly injured, but alive. Looking at aerial photos of the actual subdivision itself doesn't feel real. Every single home on this block is completely swept away. And if you notice, there's barely any debris around anywhere. In the upper left corner, there's a lot of debris, but that's the outer edge of the tornado. That was rated F4 damage. Everything towards the bottom of the screen is completely wiped away and granulated. It is incredible amount of damage. In other photos, you can see the actual ground scouring and the marks from the winds on the ground as it traveled through the area at incredibly slow speeds. This is one of the most powerful tornadoes that the United States has ever seen. Essentially, everyone in the northern part of Double Creek Estates that was home at the time was killed, 27 people in all. In the aftermath of tornadoes, you generally hear things when arriving as a first responder. People yelling for help, animals making noise, dogs barking, creaks of buildings, all of alarms going off in various locations, smoke detectors sometimes alarm in the aftermath of tornadoes just from dust buildup and all of that. But one first responder that responded to the Gerald tornado and was there immediately on scene said the only sound that they heard from this particular area was the sound of rain on mud. It was silent otherwise. And silence in the aftermath of any disaster is never, ever a good sign. Even if people are screaming and crying and praying, it means that they are alive and they need help and you can do something. If all you hear is silence, everyone is gone. When the fire department and police department began their search for survivors, they found a horrifying sight. Next to Double Creek Estates had been a cow pasture with approximately 300 cows in it. The tornado had sandblasted the skin off and removed many of their organs. Many of the cows were impaled by corn stalks, but this posed a problem for the first responders. The people of the subdivision had been subjected to the same thing. Every living being, human and animal alike, had been completely obliterated by the tornado. Pets, people, cows, all unrecognizable lumps of bloody flesh. It defies description. It is arguably one of the most horrifying things that has happened in the aftermath of a tornado. There are first responder first-hand accounts that said when they arrived, they all locked arms in an attempt to walk through the whole thing so that they could cover the entire area. And one first responder came upon a lump of essentially bloody flesh and accidentally kicked it with his foot. When he looked down, he initially thought it was a cow. When they rolled it over, it was a human woman. Unrecognizable, no idea who it was. It took extensive forensic examination to determine who was who in the aftermath of this tornado to give them proper burials. Homes of Double Creek were so thoroughly obliterated that even the plumbing was removed from most of the homes. All living things that went through the core of the tornado were gone. Humans, animals, plants, everything simply gone, granulated into tiny pieces. There were an estimated 12 cars, like full-on, full-size vehicles, known to be in the subdivision prior to the tornado, that not a single piece of them was ever found again. That means engine blocks, frames, tires, rims, all of it, completely granulated, never to be found again. If you look at these damage photos, you can see that everything is essentially gone. None of this has been cleaned up. This is immediately post-tornado. There is simply nothing left except for very tiny, small fragments of these homes. In fact, the damage was so extensive, it made actually providing a rating for the tornado difficult. Since tornadoes are rated based on damage caused by the tornado to homes of various construction type, they didn't have enough left to be able to tell how the homes were built before they were destroyed. There was nothing left to actually analyze. In fact, there was a report done by the National Institute of Science and Technology, NIST, if you're familiar with that, that said that the damage to these homes could have been done by F3 winds, but because the tornado sat in one place for so long that it completely obliterated everything else, and they simply had to give it an F5 rating because it did F5 damage. It just sat there for 3 straight minutes doing catastrophic damage. There is essentially nothing that is going to survive 260 mile an hour winds for 3 straight minutes. There's nothing that's going to survive 200-mile-an-hour winds for three straight minutes. It's simply not going to happen. You will have nothing left in that particular situation. Now, as I said, eventually this tornado received an F5 rating, and it very well deserved it. It's impossible to argue against seeing an empty slab of literally nothing left and not give it an F5 rating. In the aftermath of this tornado, much of the area was rebuilt. There exists a memorial with the names of the 27 individuals who died inside of a memorial park that sits at the entrance to the Double Creek subdivision. Almost all of the homes were also rebuilt, except for two lots, which had homes on them before the tornado, that still, to this day in 2025, sit empty of homes as a stark reminder for the deadly destruction that this particular tornado brought to the small town in Central Texas. And with that, we've reached the end of this particular episode of, I guess we're going to call it, I don't know if we're going to call it Tornado Tuesdays or Tornado Thursdays. We'll figure out which one it is, but I will let you guys know, and hopefully that will be the schedule moving forward. If you like this, like, comment, subscribe, let me know. Let me know if you have any tornadoes that you want to hear the story on, and I will do my best to provide them. I appreciate you all for being here and watching, and as always, stay safe and check your smoke detector batteries.